Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
Isn't it great to be in the Lord's house tonight?
Amen.
All right, let's go ahead and Jenny, we're going to sing a song. 1 second. All right. I'm just making sure he's coming because y'all don't want me to lead the song. I promise you that. All right. While he's making his way up here, let's go ahead and stand to our feet, grab our songbooks, and let's turn to page 56. When we all get to heaven, we're going to sing first, second, and fourth verses tonight. Page 56.
Sing the wondrous love of Jesus, sing his mercy and his grace. In the mansions bright and blessed, he'll prepare for us a place. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. While we walk the pilgrim pathway, clouds will overspread the sky. But when traveling days are over, not a shadow, not a sigh. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. Onward to the prize before us, soon his beauty we'll behold. Soon the pearly gates will open, we shall tread the streets of gold. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. Thank you. You may be seated.
All right. Before we go to the Lord in the word of prayer tonight, we want to make sure every need is met. We already got a few few more to add to the list tonight. Do we have any more needs to add on my right side tonight? All right. How about my left side? All right. Looks like the preacher was Johnny on the spot back there. All right. We're going to go ahead and have Brother Sean Horbett come up here. And he's going to start us off, but let's all give the Lord a word of prayer this time, okay? Yes, sir.
Okay. Heavenly Father, our eyes closed. Our Father in heaven, thank you for all that you do. Lord, pray for the pastor. Pray for the church attendance to continue to keep growing as far as souls being saved and lives being changed. Pray for the tithe and our giving that continues to help further your kingdom. I pray for our deacons and our trustees, just be with them. Lord, I pray for the new building and that sale of this property so that we can get on the land as quick as we possibly can so we can glorify you. Pray for Blair's construction plans, that goes well. Lord, pray for Mike Marakis, the architect. Pray for Eternal Broadcast, that continues to go worldwide, and that more people start listening to it in WBTI Broadcast in Greenville, South Carolina. Pray for Joe Arthur on October 12th through the 13th, that it'll be a packed house and souls will be saved and lives will be changed. Wilberts and Wilberts, November the 1st. Pray for Beaver's Bible Institution that will continue to grow. Pray for Sunday school and teachers. Lord, just help us continue to be a light to each and every student and open their hearts to the Lord of God. Pray for youth ministry, Lord. Pray for the church, children's church. Pray for Tuesday Bible study. Lord, I pray for the peace of Israel, elections, president, nation, and economy, Lord. Pray for the coronavirus outbreak. Pray for that to be gone, Lord. Pray for conflicts in Iraq, Iran, Afghanistan, and North Korea and Syria. Pray for all our visitors and all our new converts, Lord. I pray for all these souls that are lost. They'll come to a saving knowledge before it's too late. I pray for Carl Amos, Brandon Parents, Rachel Bowen, Jackie Bryant, Ashley Cobb, Tommy Connor, Jamie Connor, Ann Crutchfield, Clint Davis, Terry Deer, Robert Durr, Lester Dotson, Michelle Doss, Joel Dutton, Heather, Jesse Horbett, Brandon Gossie, Horsley Family, Jimmy Jones, Caitlin, Billy King, Mike King, Stephen King, Ryan, Tyler, Kinder, Buster Lewis, Essen Lewis, co-worker, Sean McCall, Chase Minter, Haley Minter, Darren Moore, Danielle Owen, Michelle Owen, Bradley Payne, Margaret Poston, Mark Reagan, Brian Reagan, Caitlin Sanchez, Victor Sanchez, Sean Bobby Stout, Kimberly Thompson, Madeline Thompson, Megan Thompson, Dustin Turner, Buddy Travis, Jessica Wood, Kelly Wood, Tommy Vincent, and Les Young. Lord, I pray for all the ones who get back in church. Lord, I pray in Jesus' name that you just get them back in here. I pray for Judy Bryant, Cleary and family, Carol Golden, Casey and family, DJ and Chelsea, Gary Graham, Kirsten McBride, Jonathan Reeve, Troy Simmons. Lord, I pray for all these health needs that they'll be met. Pray for Pamela Armstrong, stroke. Pray for Larry Bryant, heart. Austin Beggarly, Finney Beggarly, Carolyn Bonnet, Pamela and Sarah Bryant, Benjamin Bryant, Vicky Burnett, heart, Vicky Burnett's brother, Jake Hanwell, eyesight, Jamie Cole, ulcer, Tony Dalton, seizures, Trayvon, Dabbs, heart, Lori Dove, Linda Durham, Joyce Earp, Gary Eccles, Vicky Farmer Health, Amy Ferguson, Amy Grafton, leukemia and chemo, Faith Ann Holloway, knee and foot, Joseph Hazelwood, acid reflux, Ronald Hazelwood, Mary Heiss, Sean Horbert Sr., Janice Hodges, Health, Audrey Hoskins, Maureen Johnson, David Jones, blood pressure, Beverly King, Gary and Gail Kilby, Carolyn, Lewis Jacks, Gary and Kathy McCollum, Angeline Marion, John Mitchell, Linda Mitchell, Danny Martin, Hearing, Shelby Martin, Christian McBride, Betty Mitchell, Angie Moore, Toby Moore, Knee, Linda Moorefield, home, Stan Moorefield, recovering from surgery, Nancy Nukin, Bobby Nicholas, asthma, in Jesus' name.
Our most kind and gracious Heavenly Father, we continue our health needs tonight. We want to lift up Billy and Angie Oakes, Donald Owen, Alfreda Patterson, Alan Cheryl Podobinski, Ann Pruitt, Shirley Shive, Dolores Simpson, Carl Stamer, who has upcoming surgery next Wednesday, Dale Ray, Bernie Range, Robert Reed, Florence Richardson, Cindy Rutherford, Gracie Roberts, Wayne Royster, Nat and Barbara Saunders, Mike Smith, Bill and Judy Snow, Alan Taylor and Shirley Taylor, Cal Tickle with her back, and Ricky Tolan his eyesight, Terry Turner, Kenny and Angie Vipperman, Anita Warwick with her foot and back, Garland Watson and Preston Watson, Leon and Connie Wiles, Lois Witt, Harold Yancey, Rylan and Betty Yates, and Amy Young. We ask now, Father, you touch these individuals, restore their health, Father, and bring them back to worship with us, Father. We pray, Father, for those around about us that have diabetes. We lift up Ron Allen, Scott Barker, Sherry Bray, Kendall Oakes, Rod Raines and Lee Raines, Wayne Royster, Danny Moore, and Wendy Yancey. Father, we just ask you to touch these individuals, Father, help them control their blood sugars. And, Father, they need to be doing the things for their family and be back in your house and worshiping you also, Father. We thank you for what you're going to do for them in advance. We also want to lift up those with COPD, lift up Pamela Dabbs, Mike Bills, and Sheila Richardson, and also with Alzheimer's and dementia, Ronnie Durham, Mary Malone, and Amanda Watson. And, Father, there are many around about us suffering from cancer. We pray, Father, you'll touch their bodies right now as we're praying tonight, Father. We pray you'll restore their health, Father, and take the cancer away from their bodies. Be with the families that's looking after them. We lift up Joyce Abbott, who also needs salvation, Joni Atkins and Portia Atkins, Bobby Alley, David Bale, Robin Baker, Scooter Barton, Francis Bird's daughter, Ray Carson, Ronald Carey, Tammy Cox, Tom Barley, Calvin Bryan, Brenda Clarkson, Bill Cooper, Pat Dalton, Brenda Davis, Chris Davis, Thomas Dix, Kellen Dunn, Tommy Edwards, Mrs. Tom Farrell, Jeremy Ferguson, Amanda Glatter, Jesse Glasscock, April Galden, James Griffin, Sherry Grundy, Michelle Hall, Red Hardy, Lola Harper, Jimmy Hazelwood, Karen Hilton, James Holt, Pamela Hudson, James Hunley, Jason Long, Dan Mays, Wendy McGuire, Joseph Miller, Benny Montgomery, Billy Joe Moran, Karen Nations, Paula Neumerger, Marie Nestor, Ruth Patterson, John Rice, Patricia Robinson, Neil Rogers, Margaret Sexton, Sylvia Siegler, James Staples, Cindy Sawyers, Frank Wilkerson, and Albert Wilson. We also want to remember those in the nursing homes round about us. We pray you'll be with each resident, Father, and take care of their needs and give them the strength they need for each day. Pray you'll be with Dale Leffler in Ohio at Roman Eagle. Be with Catherine Collins, Susan Dooley, Curtis Martin, Ruth Newman, Joyce Thomas, Donna Wagner and Francis Robertson at Berry Hill in South Boston, be with Kathy Cole and Ruby McKee, Chatham Rehab, Vidal Crane, Michelle Johnson and Gladys Milam, and in Gretna Rehab, Eva Wiring. And Father, we're going to lift up the many unspoken requests we know of tonight, Father. We pray you'll be with these requests, Father, and not only between you and these individuals. Please be with the request of Beverly Barker, Jenny Barrett, Raymond Clay, Chad Gotze, Sean and Teresa Horbit, Janice Hodges, Van and Katie Hunt, Eston Lewis and Evan Lewis, Joshua Lindsay and Tina Lindsay, Shelby Martin, Christian McBride, Angeline Merriman, Mike and Diane Mills, Angie Moore and Kelsey Moore, Sean Patterson, Bonnie Raines, Daniel Roach, Vicki Reed, Daisy Tickle, Dal Tickle, Mike Tickle, Glenn Tickle, Eileen Tickle, Hannah Vipperman, Evelyn Wallington, Matthew and Chi Williams, and Tony Woodson. Again, Father, grant these requests, Father, according to your will, for we've asked these things in your name.
Our Heavenly Father, Lord, we just continue our prayer list, Lord. We just want to just say thank you, Lord, for all that you've done for us, Lord. Thank you for our many blessings. Lord, we're just so blessed to be in your house tonight, Lord. We just pray you just speak to our hearts, Lord. And as whatever the needs of the hour may be, I pray that they're answered at this hour, Lord. Lord, as we continue our prayer list, Lord, we ask you to please be with our missionaries, Lord. I pray you just bless them. Just give them safe travels, Lord, and just help them to win many people to you, Lord. Please be with Keith Cullors, Eddie Aleph, Randy Ashcraft, Gavonda Awaley, Bethel Baptist Missions, Ken Ream, Emmanuel Byron, David Gibbs, Evangelist Earl Clarkson, John and Mavis Coleman, Mike and Sue Cook, Stan Cullen, Joseph Delf, Christy Giacomo, Garvin Dykes, Evangelist Noah and Paula Frylord, Virgo Galah, Jimmy Harris, Larry Henderson, Adrian Hernandez, Lewis Howell, Patrick Hubbard, Frank Kinsey, George Kinsey, Nestor LeBugin, Jimmy Long, Sergio Mahangos, Ernie Mills, Nathan Miller, Tamron Mock, Alan Nye, Mike Patterson, Mike Peckoff, David Robinson, the National Pastors in Cuba and Pakistan, Dan Riker, Jay and Elizabeth Roberts, Demetrio Rodrigo, Roloff Children's Home, Jason Sobel, David Wise, and Evangelist Jeff Wells. Lord, we pray that you just be with them and bless them in a mighty way. Lord, we ask you to please be with the pastors and evangelists, Lord. I just pray you just please be with them as they under shepherd their church, Lord, for you. I just pray you just always help them just keep you uplifted, Lord, and just bless them in mighty ways, Lord. Lord, I just pray you please be with Jamie Adams, Joe Arthur, Bobby Brooks, Melvin Campbell, Kenneth Cloud, Jeff Chapman, Scott Dean, Carlton Duck, Chris Esterline, Larry Fitzgerald, Jerry Flanagan, Jerry Foley, Josh General, Donnie Glass, Frank Gooch, Mike Hurt, Jason Holly, Wade Hudson, Larry Johnson, Stephen Kennedy, Buster Kinsey, John Kinsey, Tim Kaiser, Terry St. John, Steve Lamb, Bobby Lee, Joe Logan, Carol Martin, John Mitchell, Dave Peters, Dan Shellens, Davey Shelton, Mark Snowden, Donnie Stevens, J.D. Servo, Brian Warren, and Jeff Woods. Lord, we pray you just bless them and be with them in a mighty way. Lord, we ask you to please be with our college students. Lord, we pray you just bless them and just help them just to be a light in this world, Lord, and just be with them as they study and just help them to do good, Lord. We pray you please be with Darius Goods, Trinity Langley, Joanne Jennings, Dakota McBride, Tori Underwood, Mary Sue Woodson, and Christine Yancey. Lord, we pray you bless them in a mighty way. Lord, we also have some other needs that were uplifted tonight, Lord. We ask you to please be with Ronnie Riddle, Lord, has amnesia, autism, and COPD. Sarah Bryant is at Duke. Noah and Polly Fry, Lord, recovering from COVID. Continue to be with them and bless them. Faith Ann Holly, Linda Durham in her back. Amy Young with a broken toe. Donald Irwin, sick at home. Gary Eccles in his heart. Kelly Wood, Lord, cancer and surgery Tuesday, Lord. Pray everything goes smoothly. Danny Ward, Lord, with kidney stones. Jax Edwards, Carolyn Lewis, please continue to be with the family of Pastor Carlton Dunn. Judy Forrest has eye surgery. The Tropical Storm Sally victims, Lord, please just be with them and bless them and protect them, Lord. Please be with Carl Stamler, Lord, has surgery today. Mary Killer had cancer. Kenneth Dix has pneumonia, and just please be with his family. Please be with Maggie, has a brain tumor. And Steve Wilson. Yeah, Andy Cleary is at Sova. Angela Hellway and the Baby Lord, Linda Mace and his chemo, and Olga Alvarez, Lord, has cancer, Lord, and be with my special unspoken. Lord, pray you just be with them and bless them according to your precious and holy will. Lord, we just ask you just to please be with the remainder of the service, Lord, and just pray that you touch many people tonight, Lord. Pray that souls are saved and lives are changed. For it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. All right, let's go ahead and grab our song books once again. We're going to sing another song. It is Well With My Soul, page 145. We're going to sing the first, second, and fourth verses. Let's go ahead and stand to our feet and grab 145. It is Well With My Soul.
When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say, it is well, it is well with my soul. It is
bless the offering tonight. Just remember, we have a few announcements. Tomorrow night there will be VBI at 6:30. So if you're involved with that, please make your way out. Also at 7:20, they'll be going through the book of Genesis, still with the preacher in the ladies' classroom, I believe. And this Saturday, ladies, come on out at 10 a.m. They have the prayer breakfast, and it's a good time to come, fellowship, food, and get a hold of the Lord. Amen? Amen. All right, at this time, I have Brother Ken come tell you about our offering.
Business as usual. We've got a box in the back for our 2020 collection. So also for the online, you watching, you can go to strengthnumber4today.com. There's a tithes and offering button there. Take you to our safe and secure website, and you can use your credit card or debit card there and take care of your tithes and offerings that way. You can continue also to do it by mail, P.O. Box 10004, Danville, Virginia 24543. That's the zip code for our post office, and that way Eston will know where it goes. So, because if you don't put the right number down, he does not know where it goes. I can trust him. Thanks. All right, I guess Are you going to sing Acapulco this time? Or you got, oh, got music. Okay, good. So we're going to go ahead and pray, and then Brother Jamie will sing. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you, God, for this privilege and honor to be here in the house again today. We just ask, God, that you would just bless the offering that we're about to receive this week. We ask that you may bless the gift and the giver as well. We ask, God, that you would just be with the pastor as he preaches to us tonight. Lord, just give him the word that we all need to hear to help strengthen and encourage us for these last days that we're in. We just ask, God, that you would just come and visit with us tonight. These things we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Take your Bibles and turn, if you would, to Colossians chapter 1, verse 9. We've been talking about spiritual strength, and we've already talked about, for this cause, we also, since the day we heard it, do not cease to pray for you. If you're going to have spiritual strength and grace from God, you have to pray. Then desiring, the next part of verse 9, and to desire that you might be filled with the knowledge of his will and all wisdom and spiritual understanding. You got to pray. You got to have the right desires. Then number C, walking, that you may walk worthy of the Lord. That's your testimony without the church. Outside the church, are you walking where you honor the Lord and your testimony honors him? Now we're talking about the inside tonight. We're talking about the inside. Pleasing. Colossians 1:10b. And unto all pleasing. Three words as far as we're going to get tonight in Colossians, but we're going to get a lot more scripture to go with it. But we have to come to the place in our spiritual life that the most important thing we can accomplish is to please the Lord. That's your personal goal in life is to please the Lord. The question tonight for you is, are you pleasing the Lord? Making Him happy, satisfying Him has got to become our greatest joy. Not us being happy. Let me tell you what's destroying the work of God today. It's people who are concerned about their happiness. It's not about your happiness. It's about His happiness and pleasing Him. In return for our faithful dedication, He provides the grace and the spiritual strength that we need to press on and press forward. I'm glad He's the God of all grace. Amen? He's got enough grace for us, but He can't give it to us unless we're pleasing Him. If you're not pleasing Him, it's not possible for the grace of God to rest on your life so you can move forward and be used of Him. Let's talk about three things tonight. First of all, allowed in trust. We got to understand tonight, this is not our church. This is not Walter Yancey's church. This is God's church. And it's not a right. It is not a right to serve God. It's a privilege. It's not a right that's owed you. It's not a right that's owed me. It's a privilege to serve Almighty God. So it says in 1 Thessalonians 2:4, but as we were, here's the word that tells us that, allowed of God to be put in trust with the gospel. Preaching and teaching the word of God and serving the Lord in the church is a sacred trust that God has entrusted you with. The ministry He's given you, He's entrusted you with that ministry. He's entrusted you with that opportunity. Then it says, even so we speak, not as pleasing men, but God, which trieth our hearts. Now the gospel has been placed in our hands as God's children, the stewardship of spreading a message that can change lives. There's no greater stewardship. There's no greater responsibility. There's no greater opportunity. There's nothing worth more while than sharing a story that's going to change somebody's life forever. Can you say amen to that? I can. I'll tell you, that's a privilege. And God has allowed us the privilege and the opportunity of being part of an eternally changing ministry in our lives, in the lives of other men, from our lives to theirs. It's a privilege. It's not a right. Nobody has a right to be blessed of God. It's a privilege. And if you're not pleasing Him, you won't get the privilege. You say, preacher, that's kind of tough. I can't help if it's kind of tough. It's what the Bible says. Amen? God owes you and me nothing. We owe Him everything. That includes obedience to His precepts and His principles as written in the Word of God. He trusts us to obey and follow Him. And we trust Him to empower us and lead us and guide us and direct us. It's a trust both ways. He's trusting you with the responsibility and the obligation. And He's trusting you to do it His way and to be close to Him and hold to His hand. You see, the problem is we let go of His hand. Preacher, how do you let go of His hand? In disobedience, not following the principles of the Word of God. When I was in school, fundamentalism was an important word. You don't even hear it anymore. You know why you don't hear the word fundamentalism anymore? Nobody wants to be a fundamentalist. Because to be a fundamentalist means you got to follow every word in that book. We think our church is a Burger King Baptist church. Pick and choose buffet. No. You still have to obey the Word of God. We still have to live by the fundamentals of the faith, the fundamental principles and precepts and promises that God has given us. The world wants to do away with the word fundamental. I remember when I was in school, they had a magazine called the Fundamentalist Journal, out of print. Doesn't exist anymore. They don't want to embrace fundamentalism. They want to embrace liberalism. And liberalism is a total failure. I don't care if it's in the political world, the church world, in your personal home, liberalism does not work. Fundamentalism does. It's important we understand that. It's a work of faith from both directions, God to us and us to God. And we're not to please the desires and the wills of men. This is a serious point here, because we live among men and we've never met God face to face. We've met him in our heart and our soul. We've felt him move in our lives. But the pressure of living among men can be overwhelming, to the point it causes you to break God's heart instead of pleasing God. It's not our spouse, not our children, not our employers, not our friends, our family. The Lord is trusting us to please him and him alone. That's a lonely walk in this world. You'll find yourself alone more often than you'll find yourself with somebody. Because narrow is the way that leads to life and broad is the road that leads to destruction. Isn't that what the Bible says? And so, folks, it's something that's going to be a lonely road. You're not going to be Mr. and Miss Congeniality. Everybody's not going to hug your neck and say they love you, because it's not the road most people want to walk. It's not the way they want to go. In the end of life, it will be your not be your spouse. It will not be your child, your friends, your church family, your employer that will judge you. It will be God Almighty's Son who judges you. All judgment is given to the Son, is what it says in the New Testament. So if I knew that God was going to be the one to judge me in the end, I think I'd be worried about how he felt all along. Amen? And if you forget him all along, it's not going to be a good day of judgment day. Not going to be a good day. You see, we allow others to much influence in our lives, and we allow them to have more power in our life than we ought to. And it drains us of the grace of God, and we fail him in our ministries. Do you understand that? We're always wanting to blame other things for the reason our ministers are failing. And if our ministers are failing, it's nobody's fault but ours. Because if we're connected with God, there's going to be power. I didn't say there weren't going to be problems. I didn't say there weren't going to be pressures. I didn't say there weren't going to be situations. I said you'd have power to overcome them. Somebody's always in a defeated spirit and a discouraged spirit. There's something wrong there. Because if you're holding God's hand, you should fear nothing. You shouldn't fear anything. You should be faithful. You see, God exhorts us to abound in the truth more and more. Look at 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 1. Number 2, abound by the truth. If we're going to be allowed in trust, God's entrusted us with a ministry. You've got to hold on to his hand so he can work through you. It's a trust. It's a cooperation. It's a team effort. Number 2, abounded by the truth. Furthermore, then we beseech you, brethren, and exhort you by the Lord Jesus Christ, that as you received of us how ye ought to, what's that word? Walk, and to please God. Live among men and please the Lord. Preacher, that's hard. That's exactly right. It's hard to walk in the land of men and please God, because men don't want you to please God. They want you to please them. But sometimes you have to stand for God and stand alone. Say amen. Then it says, so. Why does God want you to do that? So you would abound more and more. We ought to be abounding, not just surviving. We ought to be thriving, not just making it from day to day. I get so tired of these teachers and preachers. All they want to preach on is, let's just get from today to tomorrow. What is that? What kind of living is that? We've got a God of all grace. And we ought to be doing better than just making it from day to day. According to this verse, we ought to be abounding more and more. For ye know what commandments we gave you by the Lord Jesus. You've got the Bible. For this is the will of God, even your, circle this word, we're going to come back to it, sanctification, that you should abstain from fornication. Circle that word. That every one of you should know how to possess his vessel in sanctification and honor. God is begging us, I beseech you, he's begging us to stick to his principles, his promises, and his precepts. He's begging us. If he's begging us, that ought to give us a little indication we ought to be doing that. Amen? We ought to be living as close to him as we possibly can. In our natural flesh, we have no real idea how we ought to walk. Natural man has no idea. That's why God gave us his commandments, his principles, his promises, and his precepts. That's why he gave us the Bible. We don't lean on the opinion of people or how I feel. I hear people say, I feel, I think. I don't want to hear how you feel, how you think. I don't know where your hands have been, and I don't know where your mind's been. But I know where God's word's been. I don't want to hear how you feel or think. I want to hear what the Bible says. Because that's what God's begging us to follow, is the word of God. Therefore, we have to be taught from the Bible what is the way we ought to walk. There's no other book, no other means, no other way but the word of God. Liberalism, lackadaisical living, loose living, is just the open door the devil needs to slip into our life and put a wedge between us and God that will be detoured and diverted away from the will and the grace of God. You need to listen to your preacher tonight, whether you're here in the building or you're by internet. The church is being destroyed because we have let a wedge become between us and God. It has. And we have to get away back to God where we can hold his hand, say amen, and walk by his side. So we walk in the flesh, not in the spirit. We're walking away from the grace of God. I have people ask me all the time, Brother Walter, nothing's happening in my life. Well, if your vacuum cleaner's not working, the first thing you check is to see if it's plugged in. If your toaster's not working, the first thing you do is you check to see if it's plugged in. So if things aren't happening in your life spiritually, maybe you ought to see if your hand is in his. If you're near to him, or have you let something, a little personal thing, an opinion, a feeling, a pressure from the outside, come between you and God, and that hand is broke off of his and the power is no longer there. If we walk in the flesh and not in the spirit, we're walking away from the grace of God and not in it. And I'm afraid Satan has won a great victory in many a life just that way. Here in this verse, we're promised. And we're promised that if we do not wander off, we do not slip away from his principles and his directives, that we will abound in ministry, we will abound in miracles, and we'll abound in the marvelous. I'm having a hard time during this time, just like you are, because nothing's like it used to be. Everything's different, am I right? And things don't happen the way they used to happen. But you know, God sends little marvelous miracles along the way to let you know your hand's still in his and his hand's still in yours. I was sitting at my desk today working on this very message, and I've been praying for somebody for a long time because I could see the wedge had come between them and God. And I could see them being diverted and directed in another direction. And the phone rang. And I picked it up, and on the other end of that phone was that person I've been praying for. I said, preacher, can I talk to you? Well, certainly you can talk to me. Love to hear from you. And she began to talk to me and share her heart with me. And she said, preacher, I didn't want to come to you because I was so ashamed. Let me tell you something. There is no shame in coming back to God. I'm not your judge. I'm your pastor. Say amen. Now, sometimes I have to make judgments, and I'll do it when I have to. But I'm your pastor. I love you, and I want to help you get your hand in God's hand. We spent about a half hour on the phone talking about just how to get her hand back into God's hand and the power of God back on her life and get her life back on track. Are you listening to me tonight? It's that important. You know what that made me know when I hung that phone up? I'm on the right path. God's still using me. I'm still a vessel that God can reach. It wasn't anything I told him made a difference. I just gave her the what? The promises of God. I give her what God said. That's all we all got to do. But if our hand is not in his hand, there's no power. Listen to me, 2 Timothy 2:1, this is 3:1, this is long, but we need to be reminded of this. Because my concern for the church today is there are a lot of people working hard but accomplishing nothing. And they're scratching their head. It's because they're not paying attention to whether their hand's in God's hands or not. Because if your hand has slipped out of God's hand, the power is gone. You say, preacher, you'll know when that happens. Ask Samson if he knew when it happened. He laid his head in Delilah's lap, done what God told him not to do, and when he woke up, she says, "The Philistines be upon thee, Samson." The Bible says he jumped up like he always did to go fight those Philistines, and the power was gone. Gone. You can work your fingers to the bone, but if your hand is not in God's hand, and you're not doing it God's way, and you're not pleasing him, you're going to accomplish nothing. Nothing. The Bible says, know this, that in the last days, are we not here? Perilous times shall come, for men shall be lovers of their own selves. I got news for all of us. This ain't about us. It's about him. It's about them. Covetous, wanting their own way. Boasters, bragging about who they are and who they think they are. Proud, they're more important than anybody else. Blasphemers, disobedient to parents. Unthankful, don't appreciate anything. Unholy, nothing sacred to them. Without natural affection. Truce breakers, false accusers, incontinent, fierce, despisers of those that are good. Then the Bible says in verse 4, traitors turning on each other. You know what? Hey, it's hard to trust anybody this day and time. Now, I'm not talking about in the lost world. I'm talking about in the church world. Hard to trust people. Shouldn't be that way. We'll all be on the same team. Amen? Hey, the Bible says very clearly, lovers of high-minded, heady, high-minded, lovers of pleasures, more than lovers of who? God. Having a form of godliness. You know, there's a lot of people walking around with a Bible big as an encyclopedia. Nice suit on, nice words, nice haircut, and they're wreaking more havoc in the house of God than the bull in the china shop. Because of this, they have a form of godliness. They know how to play the game, but they don't have the power to produce. There's a difference. You know how to play Monopoly, but if you don't have the wisdom, you can't win. Amen or amen. And I'm afraid what's happening in the church today, all people are saying, aren't they great Christians? Yeah, they're great, but are they producing? Do they have the power, the anointing of God? Are things happening because their vessel is clean? Are things happening because their life is pure and they've got a good testimony, not just before men? There's a lot of people who have good testimonies before people who have a horrible testimony before God. And men can think they're the greatest thing since peanut butter. But God's looking for the hand and he can't find it. He can't find it. He can't give them any power. Oh, the Bible says, but denying the power thereof from such, turn away from it. For this is the sort of they which creep into houses, lead captive silly women laden with sins, led away with divers lusts. Look at verse 7. Ever learning, but never able to come to the knowledge of the truth. In other words, let me put it in a little clearer terms. They know the Bible from Genesis to Revelation and quote it frontwards and backwards, but they're not living it. They're not obeying it. You know the facts all day long, but if you don't apply them to your life, it's useless. And God said, I beg you. Did he not? He said, I beg you. I'm begging you, brethren, to exhort you by the Lord Jesus that you receive of us how you ought to walk and to please God. He said, I'm begging you. Put your hand in mine. And what that means is walk beside him so that your testimony is that you please him. That means you're not going to please people. That means people are not going to like you and be happy with you. It means people are not going to support you and stand by you. But you don't need people. You need him. Amen? You need his presence. We are either living in the spiritual sanctification or we're living in fleshly fornication. Now, look at the word sanctification. I found a great definition today for sanctification. It's the state of growing in divine what? Didn't say people's graces, the Queen's graces. It says growing in divine graces. As a result, listen here now, of Christian what? Commitment after baptism or conversion. In other words, after you got saved, you were 100% committed to doing what God said do, when he said do it, the way he said do it, without compromise. That's what that means. Sanctification is a $1,000 word from what? Pleasing who? Pleasing God, doing what he says. When I was young, I was smart enough at a young age to learn. As long as I was pleasing mama, Walter was in good graces. But when Walter didn't please mama, he was not in good graces. Anybody else learn that besides me? Some of you lying in here or either you're in trouble. I don't know which one. I don't know which one. But I learned from my mama how it ought to be with God. As long as I'm in good graces with God, I'm going to be okay and I'm going to be a blessing to other people. It's going to be a shame to get to the judgment seat of Christ and know all you know about the Bible and all you've tried to do only to get to heaven to find out you lived your whole life unplugged. Preacher, that couldn't happen. Yeah, it could. That's what the devil wants to happen. He wants you to live your whole life unplugged without the grace of God and the power of God in your life. Sanctification is not something divinely granted to you. It's earned as you study, as you surrender, as you submit, and as you serve by the truth of God's word. Not the desire of your heart or the opinion of men. God's not just going to pour some holy water on you and say, you're sanctified. No. Sanctification comes every day of your life. Pleasing God. Now let's look at that second word I said let's look at. Fornication. That's sex outside the bonds of marriage. I ain't doing that, preacher. Praise God for that. Say amen. Hallelujah. I'm glad you're not. But there's a connotation here that if you don't stop and take a deep breath and understand what that's being said here by Paul to Timothy, you'll miss it. Fornication is sex outside of marriage. Therefore, in the spiritual realm, sin is sex outside the marriage with God. Am I right? So if we commit spiritual fornication, we can't have sanctification. We can't have the hand of God on our life, the power of God on what we do. Marriage is a picture of our eternal relationship with Jesus Christ. Therefore, it is the opposite of sanctification, living by the commands and the truths of God. If you refuse to live by the words of God and you're committing spiritual fornication, and it's impossible for you to grow in the grace of God. That's why in church you have some people shouting hallelujah and the other people are grumbling under their voices. Because not everybody's on the same page. We ought to be. Sometimes some people on and some people off. It's a daily thing. But it's all up to you. You can't blame somebody else if you're not sanctified. You can't blame somebody else if you're falling into sin. It's a personal what? Choice. It's a personal choice. You see, our churches are full of Christians who are not sanctified. And they're tearing our churches apart. And they're draining our churches of the power of God. And our churches can't do what they ought to do because the pews are full of unplugged Christians. People who want to run and lead the church, yet they're not sanctified. They're not doing what they ought to, so they're causing more damage to the work of God than they are good. Folks, that's a serious responsibility for me. And I got news for you. That's a serious responsibility for you. Making sure we're plugged in and not doing more damage than we're doing good. You can do good deeds and works all day long, but if your heart is not in sync with God's principles, you're powerless and deadly destructive to the work of God. It's a personal thing. You're denying the power thereof. You see, number one, we allow to trust. Number two, we abound by walking in the truth. Now let's look at number three. Assiduously trusting. Assiduously trusting. Preacher, what in the world does that mean? Doing it with all your heart. Doing it with all your soul. Assiduously trying to hold on to God's hand. Look at Hebrews 11:6. But without faith, that's forsaking all our trust him, it's impossible to please him. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he's a rewarder of them that, what? Diligently seek him, assiduously trying to find God's hand and hold on to it desperately. Hold on to it with all your heart. Hold on to it with all your soul. And hold on to it with all your mind. It takes great faith. It takes faith. And without faith, you'll never please the Lord. And along with that, you can never bless. He can never bless your ministry. And he never can reach down and help you service, be a service of him. Because you haven't diligently saw his hand. If we believe he's God and his word is right, then we will unequivocally obey it, follow it, preach it, and teach it. You can pray until the stars fall out of heaven, but if there's sin between you and God, he cannot hear you, he cannot help you, because you did not heed him. We've got to listen to God. We've got to cut our ears off to the voices of people. And we must, with all our heart, soul, and mind, listen to every word that God tells us. Now, you can blame the preacher. You can blame your teacher. You can blame your family. You can blame your circumstances of life. But the truth is that you and I are ultimately responsible for our own assiduously trying. We're responsible for everything we do and every step we take. Is it in his hand or out of his hand? He only rewards those who diligently seek him with all their hearts, souls, and minds, and half-heartedness does not cut it with God. See, people get mad at me because I don't believe in doing anything half-hearted. Because half-heartedness doesn't cut it with God. Halfway just doesn't do. A lick and a promise is not going to make it happen. But assiduously trying does. It takes believing, pleasing, striving, seeking, serving, submitting, before God rewards us with his hand of powerful grace. It's not just something he owes you. He doesn't owe it. You owe him. Amen? You owe him. I owe him. That he is. Look back at verse number 6. That he is. That phrase, that little teeny phrase, is proclaiming that God is, and there's nobody else we can trust. God does exist, and he's not going away. God is going to be there now and in the end. You can't move him off the scene. God is. There's no other that can help you. There's no other way you can go. There is no other work you can do. There's no other power you can have. He is it. He's everything. Bow or yield to no other. We must seek him. Deuteronomy 4:29. But if from thence thou shalt seek the Lord with thy God, thou shalt what? So if you try, you're going to find him. There's no, you can't say, well, I couldn't find him. No, you didn't seek hard enough. But if you'll seek, you'll find him. If thou seek him with all thy heart, with all thy soul. 1 Chronicles 28:9. And thou, Solomon, my son, know that the God of thy father, and serve him with a, what kind of heart? Complete heart. And with a willing mind. For the Lord searcheth, how many hearts? All hearts. And understandeth all imaginations of the thoughts. You can't trick him. He even knows what you think. If thou seek him, he will be found of thee. If thou forsake him, he will cast thee off forever. Take heed now, for the Lord hath chosen thee to build an house for the sanctuary. Be strong and do it. Stop making excuses. Stand up and take him by the hand. Walk with him down the road. Stand by his side. Don't ever leave him or forsake him. If the devil turns a light up, turn the light on. Say amen. And find him. Find him. Psalms 22:26. The meek shall eat and be satisfied. They shall praise the Lord that, what? Seek him. But look at this. It says, your heart shall live forever. I want to live, don't you? I want to live in the miracles. I don't want to live in fuss and fight and feud. I don't want to live in sad sorrow and depression. Amen? I want to live in joy, happiness, and miracles. I want to get more phone calls like I got today. I want to get more blessings than I got like I got yesterday. Boy, I'll tell you, God just does things for me that I get discouraged, and he'll do something and pump me up. But if you're not holding his hand and you get discouraged, there's nobody to pump you up. That's a fact. Here's the tickle verse, Psalm 119:2. Blessed are they that keep his what? His word. And that seek him with a whole heart. And they also do know what? Iniquity. Let me tell you something. If it's wrong for me to do it, it's wrong for you to do it. If it's wrong for one side to do it, it's wrong for the other. The Bible's the same book for everybody. God said, do no iniquity. They shall walk in his what? Thou shalt hast commanded us to keep thy precepts. You know what's that word? Assiduously. Diligently. We're to strive to be close to him. Lighten up a little bit, preacher. I can't lighten up. The truth is too clear. If we do not seek him, if we do not obey him, if we do not trust him in his word, we're walking alone in a world of demons and devils that will kill you and destroy you and wreck your life without a moment's notice. And I'm afraid some of our Christians have took the hand out of God's and they're wandering in the darkness. And without a moment's notice, their lives are going to be wrecked and destroyed, ruined. And I don't want God to ever say, Walter, it's your fault because you didn't stick by the stuff. You didn't stick by my word. You didn't hold my hand. And because you didn't hold my hand, this life was wrecked, and this life was ruined, and this soul went to hell, and this soul went to hell. I don't want to hear that. How about you? I don't want to hear that. I cannot afford, and you cannot afford, to slack up, slip up, or slow up. Because I'm telling you here tonight, the reason I am determined to stay a fundamentalist on the principles of God as your pastor is because the devil does not give up. I'm seeing him destroy families, people, lives, communities, every day, because people aren't concerned about making sure their hands in God's. There's too much to gain to lose. Every head's bowed, every eye's closed. Father, I've preached your word as best I can tonight. Lord, I pray if there's one within the sound of my voice that knows not Jesus Christ as their personal Lord and Savior, I pray tonight they'll call on Jesus to save them right now. And ask Christ to come into their heart and forgive their sins and give them a new life in Christ. I pray Christians will look at their hands and ask themselves the question, am I sure? I know I'm saved, but am I holding to his hand? Is the grace of God on my life? Am I assiduously, diligently seeking him and trying my best to cross every T and dot every I to keep my hand in his so he can keep his power in my life? I don't want to deny the power thereof, but I want to accentuate his power through my life to the lives of others, that souls may be saved and lives may be changed. God, speak to our hearts. Draw us close to you. Speak to every heart in this invitation, I pray, in Jesus' name. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. Softly and tenderly, Jesus is calling. Answer him. Answer him.
Softly and tenderly, Jesus is calling. Calling for you and for me. See on the portal, he's waiting and watching, watching.